I'm going back a little bit here, I'm sorry, so I'm in the talk, but we already know that we have many transgenic crops that are grown commercially. BT cotton is an example. BT maize in 2006 was sown on 280,000 square kilometres. It's probably twice that now or more. So there's no doubt GM technologies are being used and they are safe. They're being used all around the world and increasingly. We don't have GM wheat yet, but it's coming. It's technically possible, but it doesn't yet have public acceptance. And this is just going back and telling you what I was saying before. What we're wanting to do is to take genes like, let's say, LR21, which is on chromosome 1D, YR36 for stripe rust on chromosome 6B, LR34YR18 on chromosome 7D, isolate them, stick them together, and put them back into wheat. People often say to me, oh, you're one of those plant breeder types, you're doing this Frankenstein food and you're genetically engineering plants and you're playing around with genomes and stuff. And I say, well, really, one of the things we really want to do is all we want to do is take genes out of wheat and put them back into wheat. So this is not transgenic, this is cisgenic. And have them inherited as a single trait and lower the probability and just make it so much easier to get multigenic resistance. Now, the problem with that work, this sounds very nice, and we've actually cloned, these are the genes that have been cloned from wheat, and in fact there are a number that can be added to this. We can add SR50, LR67 I think, and SR22 I think has been cloned, and maybe one or two others. The rate at which these things are being isolated is increasing because the cost of sequencing is coming down so quickly. The problem with this technology is that these are big genes, right? I think LR34, it's in the order of kilobases. It's a big gene. So when you start sticking three or four genes together, the construct is getting huge. To get stable integration through transformation is really hard. So yes, we've got the genes. We've got genes that are effective. We know how to transform wheat, but actually getting stable integration of three or more, four or more genes is very, very difficult. And that's what people are working on now. They're now looking at other ways of doing this. You can't just fire a construct like that in to wheat or use agrobacterium transformation. You've got to use some other tricks. So we've still got a way to go on this technology, but I think it's very exciting, and to me, this is the future. Having said that, I don't think it's going to solve the problem of rust in wheat. We're working with a biological system. These pathogens don't sleep unless they're put into liquid nitrogen, and they'll find a way, you know. So yes, we can develop new technologies. I think this is a really exciting approach, holds great promise for the future, but you know, it's not going to solve the problem of rust in wheat completely. Okay, time?
You've got about 10 minutes, maybe?
All right, so I've just given you a number of examples how we can use the markers in the plant, right? First of all, to map resistance genes, to find out what chromosome they're on. Also to develop markers that are linked to the gene that help us select those genes in marker-assisted selection. And also the technology of genome sequencing to help us actually get down to the gene level, isolate the gene, and then hopefully develop genetic engineering approaches, transformation approaches to develop cisgenic approaches to rust control in wheat. That's the host side. We can also use the markers in the pathogen side to help us, as I said before, with diagnostics and understanding how pathogens evolve, the rust pathogens evolve, and how they overcome resistance. So we've developed a series of microsatellite markers in the wheat stem rust genome, but these are also available for the stripe rust pathogen and for the leaf rust pathogen. We also have them for crown rust pathogen of oats, for the leaf rust pathogen of barley. And these are really, really nice markers to look at variation, genetic variation, beyond the level of the pathotype. So what I'm just going to give you an example here. I showed this picture yesterday, and I said this is an example of one of what we call our clonal lineages in our stem rust population, right? It goes back to an introduction in 1954. And we think we've had more than 130 pathotypes come from that pathotype through single-step mutation, just acquisition of virulence for resistance genes. And that's what all of these are. They're just mutants, we would think, that have come from this guy here through single-step mutation. Now, if that's the case, their genotype should be pretty much the same, right? They're different pathotypes, but their genotype, when we look at them with molecular markers, should be all the same, more or less. So I had a student a few years ago, and I got her to take out this original 21-naught pathotype that came in 1954. The important thing is we have all these isolates in our collection in liquid nitrogen, so we can go back and take them out now and test, right? So I got her to take out the original one from 1954 and extract DNA from it, and then we took out a whole series of other pathotypes that we believe were related to this one simply through mutation. And we then ran microsatellite markers on them. This is just one microsatellite marker here, all right? If they're mutants, that's what we would have expected to see. All the same SSR genotype. That's what we should have seen. This allele here, you see how this one's just got a band here? All of these should have looked the same. If our hypothesis that these are all mutants of this original one is correct, this is what they should have looked like. But they didn't. They looked like that. So in fact, and this really surprised me, because I was quite confident we would see that these things all belong to one genotype, because we were very confident that they were all just simple mutational derivatives of this one here. In fact, we found four genotypes. This is the yellow, the black, the red, and the blue. Four different genotypes. And this indicated that while single-step mutation of virulence is likely occurring, other processes are also occurring. So what I mean by this first part, that this is actually occurring, is that this black genotype, right, that's the original one here, we did actually find some isolates in our collection that were the same genotype as this 21-naught, and they had additional virulences. So these are, in all probability, single-step mutants of that original one with the same genotype. And some of these I think these ones here were collected 30 years after this one. So that's evidence of clonality in the pathogen population and single-step mutation. But these other things tell us that there must be something else going on. They're not the same genotype. Similar pathotypes, but different genotypes. So there's a whole range of explanations for that. One is that these could have been introduced from some other part of the world, and we didn't realise that because as pathotypes, they were very similar to this one. There could be somatic hybridisation going on, this exchange of nuclei. We know we don't have sexual recombination in stem rust in Australia. We don't have Barbary. But it's possible we could be getting this asexual exchange of the nuclei that I told you about the other day, where the rusts actually, the hyphae fuse and the nuclei are swapped around. We don't really know, but what it does tell us is that our original idea that the vast majority of the variation we're seeing in Australia is mutation, is probably wrong. All right, so the markers are telling us, the DNA markers are telling us that we were probably wrong on that one. So we're now going in and doing sequencing to try and figure out, we're going to the next level of refinement and going down to the genome level and the sequencing to try and work out what's going on here.